come to fruition, which is, I think, putting a smile on a child's face at the end of the day is the biggest joy. I always tell medical students, you know, Jesus never went to medical school. He could heal and cure. It's not the MD degree, it's the passion and compassion. So I think having that whole approach of where you actually think, we're suffering from medical conference, building drugs or producing drugs for the sake of really profits. I think the medicine and medication is for patients and people, not for profit. Profit always comes. You know, so that's the take-home message, is that doing research in your area, just think the service is the rent we pay for the privilege of being part of a great society. Half-life of a manuscript, you know, I could tell all the graduate students, is a few minutes. Once it's published, it's obsolete, right? So think about something that you could actually leave a legacy behind. So the other project we're working on is actually mind control. So we have these electrodes you can mount, and then whatever Thomas does, the monkey actually will mimic those things. Because if you think about brain functioning, if you're imaging my brain, and I am grabbing this remote control, and then you ask me only to imagine the same area in my brain light up. So you know which area will really light up. We can bring in young students and, you know, kids, and they could not only really learn this very, very, very quickly, but the machine can also learn. And we train them to really control this little cube inside the tunnel, up and down and left and right. And when they get good at it, we can get a summer student, she can't see the car, but she only thinks about it that it, she needs to drive this back and forth. And after the first try, there'll be some bumps and crashes. But a little bit of practice, you can get them to actually control with exquisite accuracy. It's actually better than Google Car. And it won't crash. But this is one approach. The other thing you can actually do is that you can use the same approach to fly a drone by just thinking about this. And of course, I have to send students in the corridor to see if Dean is not coming. There's no senior leader around. And we're not really normally allowed to do this in the corridors or in the lab. But we do this anyway. So we build the little sensors on this little drone. This can provide feedback to those electrodes that are mounted in the scalp. And then you are in constant really communication to provide feedback, not only the positional or any other sensors. And it actually lands it pretty safely. So this is really one approach. And I think I also hear that Sarah and her team is really working on post-traumatic stress disorder. And I think that really is also brings in a tremendous hope using augmented reality, where you can have really virtual reality hardware and software that can take you into a scenario where, for example, a soldier stepped onto a mine, a landfill, and then many of his colleagues and comrades were hurt or if they died. And you can take them back in the same situation and see if you can actually bring them out with a better outcome. So, you know, these technologies that are slowly and gradually filling the gaps that will eventually lead us to the first video I showed you, where when we reach the point of singularity, what will actually happen? You know, there are many ethical questions that are centered around. So we might be able to actually do a number of things, from robotic surgeries, where the robot sits in a very different place, and surgeon in a different city or country can perform surgeries. It can do just about everything else, but I'm afraid that it can't find you love. So I'll stop at that, and I'll be happy to take questions. Thank you. So, you know, when a baby's born, baby actually has twice the number of brain cells.
Twice the number of brain cells
that what you have right now. So you actually have twice the number of brain cells, but soon after birth, here onwards there will be no natural replacement of integrated tissue. You have to cope with whatever you have. And that exhibits a normal synaptic plasticity. That allows you to be able to really use the existing networks to perform the function that is otherwise deficit. So normally they say in a child's brain there are 30,000 synapses every 10 minutes. And it is really like a popper. You put new synapses, yes. And it's just like you put corn in a popper and then they just pop. Right? So this allows you to be able to deduce whether these synapses continuously form. So if you don't use it, you actually lose those synapses. So for example, in hibernating animals like, you know, bears, when the temperature drops, they can't regulate, their activity goes down. When the activity goes down, those synapses are dismantled. Songbirds, these parts of the brains are regenerated, but they also have these new synapses formed. So it's a constant, really, tug of gain and loss, but it depends on how extensively you use your neuronal circuits. But in a child's brain, it's 30,000 synapses every 10 minutes. It's just an incredible rate at which they make these synaptic connections. Some research has actually shown that in the area of hippocampus, this is where learning and memory occurs, you do have stem cells, and these stem cells actually produce neurons. And these neurons get preferentially recruited into the new circuit. So this old dogma that there is no really new addition of brain cells is true for the 90% of the brain, and an exception could be in the hippocampus area, right? So hippocampus is where it goes constantly through a learning and memory paradigm.
Talk about how much data is available now. Objects that we could look at, if you break into the data we can play with.
Great question. So, you know, the data that we have, and we think it's solvable, and we were really amazed because when we grow these cells in a simple system, simple level, we can monitor the activity of a single cell from a sphere to growth to connectivity. We have all of that data. And you know, going through that data or developing an algorithm that allows you to actually decipher that when cell is sitting by itself as quiescent, it picks up the activity, and then when it branches, there's a burst. Every time we see when it starts to branch, there's a burst of activity. Or when it connects with other neurons, its firing patterns actually change. We do have that data. We also have data from these large neuronal networks, which is like a neuronal avalanche. And the reason we are interested in this is that if we can actually decode the firing patterns of these neurons, we will decode the DNA of brain. Right? We will know the sequences. We know that no two thumbprints are identical, no two irises are identical, no two neurons are identical. So if I were to design a simple cup electrode that I can actually attach to your sciatic nerve, and I program it to detect the firing of C fibers, which is non-myelinating fibers that carry pain to your spinal cord, to your brain, and it like your cell phone is sitting quietly. The moment those cells fire, we have programmed it to respond to those cells, and it locks onto the same frequency and blocks the conduction before it actually gets to your brain. So think about addiction too. Your nucleus accumbens in your brain, these cells fire very unique firing patterns. And if you can decode the firing patterns of those neurons, bingo. So I think whether you can enhance capabilities of brain cells, and our children are hospital, and I'll get in trouble, people use transcranial magnetic stimulation to perturb the behavior of these children who are either hyperactive or have obsessive compulsive behavior. So they put electrodes at specific areas in the brain, and then they pass high magnetic stimulation, they, kids can actually drop, they can sit like calm and nice kids that you want to actually adopt them. My question always is that whenever brain is something else has to give in. Something else has to. Because you have only a certain number of brain cells and connections that you have the ability to be able to perform in. And the important question that often comes is that if Mother Nature designed humans as the most sophisticated, how come invertebrate snails, like, you know, they can regenerate, but humans cannot? And actually the reason is that if you start to sprout in the area that you're not supposed to go, no, there's one way or no entry, these brain cells cannot enter. So if I take a graft from the spinal cord, the peripheral nervous system, I transplant it in the brain, I can actually get these neurons to regenerate across. So it's not that neurons are not capable of, it's the environment is not conducive, and it's designed specifically to avoid any of these mismatches. But to get to the question that, you know, how much of the brain we really use, actually maybe 3%, maybe 4%. Einstein may have used 5%. Why is it? It's not the inability of brain cells to function. It's actually inability of your heart to provide them with food, which is blood. So 20% of your blood actually goes to your brain, and that is the rate limiting factor for enhancing any capabilities. So, you know, if you have a near-death experience, when you're going and all of a sudden you're about to crash, your adrenaline flows, it pumps your heart, blood goes to your brain, it jogs your memory that you thought you had no recollection of. When you were 2 years or 3 years old, your life flashes. So all of that is stored, but we have forgotten the name of the file, we've forgotten the name of the folder, we can't retrieve that file anymore. So I think it's not that your brain cells are not capable or we cannot enhance their potential, it is just that you cannot supply them enough blood, enough nutrients. So one brain cell uses same amount of energy than an Airbus per body weight. And you can imagine what highly, you know, octane the acid really needs to be able to really fly. So, you know, this is one of the reasons that we cannot enhance or increase the powers. But we can definitely perturb the distractions by blocking that pathway, either pharmacologically or through electrical stimulation to allow this now thing, other brain cells, to function, because that function was undermined by hyperactivity in certain areas of your brain.
So years ago, I, you know, 15 years ago, I remember reading a Nature magazine and it was talking about glial cells and how glial cells do more than just support, so they're the part of the function. And you mentioned them again in your talk today. But what I don't, despite this, if you look, know this for a while, I don't see anyone looking at them in terms of BMIs or even in terms of how that relates to machine learning algorithms. Can you comment?
I think it's a great question. It's really a multi-million dollar question. The issue is that, you know, you cannot record from them from an excitable perspective. You know, their silent partner, their so-called glutamate in the terminal, their modified synaptic transmission, they will react to certain ways, but we don't have any means of measure. Their numbers are even more complex, enormous. But we don't have any particular way of tagging their electrical activity or their electrical signals. They don't have action potentials. They do have resting memory potentials, but it's really, the signal is so tiny that no existing chip, even ours, cannot pick those sub-threshold currents that they may generate. But I think that would be something to really pay very close, important attention to. They are not just glue as they were perceived. They are tripartite, you know, partners, and they play a very important role in terms of integrating brain cells activity, but some people still believe that they are not the command system. They are only the support system. We need to really crack into the command system first and see if we can find out how these different extracellular or extra neuronal components play an important role in modulating the efficacy or the synaptic input of its neural network. But I totally agree with you. I think this is something that will be another holy grail of neuroscience when we get to it. But right now, people are still trying to figure out neurons and neuronal activity. We've moved away from conventional extracellular recordings, you know, these chips which really use, you know, main like electroporesing the cells because they create a current under the cell, and it fries those neurons, and they electroporate to create speed. So what we have done is that we have developed transistors and capacitors that only create charge underneath the cell. So no current actually passes through. So it is like one neuron actually talking to other neurons in that relationship. And our new chip is 300 times more sensitive than anything else. And we now begin to actually pick up those non-synaptic current EPSPs and IPSPs. And I think now is the time to start playing with the glia as well. Challenges right now. If you have spinal cord, for example, paralysis, we know your spinal cord actually has a central type generator. So when I was probably your age or younger, I was watching the Second World War movie, and I see the British soldiers get out of the trench, and they're firing their guns and attacking Germans, and a grenade falls in front of this person, is decapitated, but it continues to run and fire. Right? That's scaring the bejesus out of the soldiers, and they left it, they thought British could fight without their heads intact. Somebody defined them as demons of the battlefield. So your spinal cord actually has the circuitry that can generate rhythm, but it loses the command from the command center. So moving this technology forward will be to, after controlling prosthetic legs, because half of them attach, people who are paraplegic completely, could you actually provide a chip that could become that command? And I can hand you a remote control that controls your hub center or your central pattern generators in your spinal cord, and you actually use it to move forward, fast turn, left turn, right. I think that will be another grand challenge in that field. Similarly, people who have bipolar disorders, if you can, you know, schizophrenia, other mental illnesses, if we can decode the firing patterns of those neurons, you could program a chip that can detect the activity of those neurons and alter the behavior of those neurons before it actually becomes a full-blown motor reflex. But you know, the current time, if I can see a smile on the child's face who can walk because of the technology, will be the actual joy for now. But you know, in the United States, they will ask me a question, what are the really ethical implications? And I didn't intentionally show some of the stuff. We can actually take a big giant crab, which remote its ganglia and control locomotion. We designed a chip, which is a simple chip connected to this nerve. And in these crustaceans, if you kill the cell, the axon saves a life for months. So you can actually use a remote control and get this crab just moving around. And then you think about programming it in such a way that you put a chip in one crab and the other in the other crab, but this one moves, the other one moves. Now I get all kinds of people after me. So I know, what are the ethical implications? I think, you know, I always say the science is nothing to be ashamed of, even in the ruins of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Science comes. Science job is to really advance the knowledge, advance the field. How people are going to use it? It's a common thing that we all have to agree on certain things that should and should not be done. But we're not there yet, so don't panic. Yes? Another great question. So I actually gave one of my students a task. I said, when the aircraft takes off, autopilot takes over, right? And the pilots are not, they're not allowed to touch the aircraft. So I said, here's a flight plan. Fly an aircraft from Calgary and landed in Ottawa without pilot. So he had over 150,000 neurons, and he programmed each and every electrode as they were connecting, and then in stimulating cells that fire together, they get wired together. So these neurons get connected depending where you stimulate. The next cell fires, the next cell fires. He could actually design a flight simulator that could take off an aircraft still have to test it experimentally. I'm talking to Air Canada WestJet. They're willing to do a concurrently. We can actually we've taken these neurons on the chip and recorded their activity during flight takeoff and landing. People always think that these guys are nuts, you know, they're carrying something in their hands. But I think you can reprogram these circuits because they are naive networks. So cells that fire together, they wire together. You can design them to sing a Chinese symphony or any other music, because each and every neuron, you can define it as a guitar or a drum. And the intensity of stimulation and the duration and the frequency will determine how long that electrode stays turned on. And then the other cells will actually connect accordingly. So we need people in this room who could really help figure out what it all means. We have reached a stage where we can tap into this, but we don't really know what the applications could be. Pre-construction, reverse engineering. So in a rat's brain, we actually can slice the brain, 40, 50, 60, 300 micron. We know layer by layer reconstruction of these neurons as to what these circuits are, how they're configured. So you can record currently, concurrently from 8, 10 of those slices concurrently, and then put it all together in one place. That provides you a spatial temporal pattern in which these brain cells communicate with each other, and you can deduce as to which particular cell or the group of cells which is connected is actually integrated with other networks of brain cells. So I think once you can create this atlas of firing with morphological trajectories of the brain, you could then extrapolate. I mean, we work with rats, but rats is 150 million years ahead of us. The sensory system is much smarter, their immune system is much more smarter. So I don't know whether any information we gain from there is any useful to humans, because we are radically out of control. We can't predict two humans, because no two humans are identical. But there are certain generalities that you could draw from some fundamental principles. And the principles are that Mother Nature is very conservative. Mother Nature is an engineer. It decided that this is a pipe, and I have to pass water through it, a current. Bigger the better. So that's what squid giant acts on. It's big, right? Currents go through. There are some leakage. That's okay. Most of it goes through. But then Mother Nature decided that, I have to make a human. If I took this axon and Syed's head, it will be bigger than city of Calgary. So what do I do? He says, well, if I shrink the size with the same number of whole per surface area, which are ion channels, the current leaks up. Nothing goes forward. So how do we solve this problem? So let's put the tape. So that's the myelin sheath, right? So the myelin sheath came in place to prevent, and then there's nodes of Ranvier. So Mother Nature actually reverse engineers everything. A neuron is a neuron is a neuron. A synapse in a worm or a fruit fly or a snail is a synapse. So I think, we could reconstruct all these aspects from, cultured neurons to intact brain, and then try to come up with some understanding that will draw general principles.
You said it cuts a slice off of the red brain, and you can record signals from it. How does it stay alive in that slice?
So I showed you in the beginning that we had developed an incubator, and we provided really with CO2, GCO2, we maintained the temperature, is everything, and we perfused the slice. So it largely.
Do cells need blood or oxygen?
So it's in the perfusion. You perfuse hyperoxygenated solution, which is the saline, right? So that keeps those brain cells alive for weeks. And so we can actually take in and developing a newborn mice, and we can cut the spinal cord, and the neurons have just reached the dorsal and ventral horn, and we put them on the slice, and they actually develop the way they will develop in the intact animal. But now we can monitor the activities of these neurons.